And so we must now come to the end of March is 90s month. And I can't think of a better way to end our revisionist look at the 90s sucked meme than with the sliver of nerd culture where it is by far most often invoked. Comics. Sure, there was bad television, bad movies, bad music, and bad fashion in the 90s, but it tends to get balanced out either by the good stuff or by sincere nostalgia for the not-so-good stuff. But when it comes to comic books, it often feels like most of the fandom is ready to just write the whole damn decade right off. Granted, this was the era when the industry hit its highest peak ever, only to come crashing spectacularly down to earth, but there was much more than that at play. To fully understand why 90s comics are so uniquely infamous, one has to understand the four separate yet confluent phenomena that conspired to cause all the madness. The Dark Age, the rise of the superstar artist, Image Comics, and the speculator bubble, each of which could be the subject of a feature-length documentary in and of themselves. We've got about 5.5 to 6 minutes. Let's see if I can pull this off.
Comics are weird!
Okay, quickly as possible. In 1986, Watchmen and The Dark Knight Returns both hit the stands. Two books about classic-style superheroes reimagined as dark, brutal, and sexually charged epics. Suddenly, mainstream popular culture woke up to the idea that comics could be both literally and superficially grown up, which in turn led to the grown-up longtime fans of the genre, who had been quietly keeping the industry sales numbers humming for years, to be more publicly open about their comic book hobby. Publishers figured out that they could make more money selling more expensive merchandise to older fans, rather than just scrambling for the meager allowances of children, and sell more books by making the characters they already had more mature, in the most pandering and superficial way possible. By the time the 90s were on the horizon, these factors had helped to create... The vast hordes of newly out-of-the-closet comic fans weren't just buying new books and expensive merchandise, they were rebuying classic comics that had made them fans to begin with and catching up on the decades of Marvel and DC Universe continuity that informed the stories they were reading today. Funny thing about that, though, since comics had until now been regarded as disreputable and disposable medium for children, very little effort had ever been made to preserve older comics, making the few that remained major collector's items with extravagant price tags to the right collector. Soon, news reports were hitting daily, all telling versions of the same amazing human interest story. Holy crap! I bought this comic for pennies as a kid, and I just sold it for thousands! Some canny business types called speculators got an idea from this. They would buy some comics that looked like they'd be worth a lot of money later on now and hold on to them as investments, angling that these books might appreciate in value the same way the older ones did. But how would they find the right books? Okay, guys, yes, I know, you've already figured out why this was a stupid idea, but let me finish the story, okay? Ahem. How to find the right books? Well, by paying attention to the types of old books that fetched high prices. Debut issues, first appearances of popular characters, deaths of popular characters, shocking story turns, artwork by specific now-famous artists. Soon, publishers learned to take advantage of this interest by gearing their books toward creating as much of those kinds of issues as possible. They killed major characters, created tons of new ones, staged lots of big twisty event storylines, and they pulled stunts like limited edition covers and giveaways, but what they did most was heavily promote the involvement of a new generation of artists. Fairly or not, with the notable exception of the king of all self-promoters, Stan Lee, comic book artists have up until recently always gotten more attention than comic book writers. And with comics being more visible than ever, the big artists of the late 80s and early 90s were bigger names than almost any other artist before them. Sure, they weren't exactly movie stars, but guys like Jim Lee, Rob Liefeld, and Todd McFarlane had public profiles that dwarfed that of even the late great Jack Kirby. For the first time, thanks in no small part to the aforementioned speculation investors, books could turn a profit just on the name of the artist, and publishers looked to keep them happy and prolific by letting them write books as well, so they could have more control. Granted, a lot of them weren't nearly as good at writing, we'll come back to that, but given the kinds of writing publishers were looking for, they didn't need to be. And yet, they still didn't feel like they had enough say over their own work. From the very beginning of the comic book industry, pretty much all work done by a writer automatically became the property of the publisher, including concepts and characters they created. For example, when he became Canada's representative on the new international-flavored X-Men in 1975, Wolverine became one of Marvel's most popular and profitable characters for selling toys, shirts, etc. But the guy who created Wolverine didn't see the kind of royalties you might expect. He already got paid his salary for writing the issue of The Hulk where Wolverine was first introduced. This had obviously never sat well with anyone in the business, but now the aforementioned superstar artist figured they might have some pull to make new demands, specifically of Marvel, who was at the time regarded as the bigger offender of the two publishers. When Marvel didn't budge, six of the industry's biggest guns of the moment, Eric Larson, Rob Liefeld, Jim Valentino, Todd McFarlane, Jim Lee, and Mark Silvestri, with ideological support and backing from Wilson Portaccio and Chris Claremont, shook the industry by quitting and founding their own publishing company, Image Comics, which soon drew even more talent from around the industry thanks to its promise of autonomy and emphasis on creators' rights to their own intellectual property. A lot of Image's books sold really well, and soon they were getting movie, toy, and cartoon deals that rivaled those of Marvel and DC. For just a minute there in the 90s, things were looking really, really bright. Well, everything fell apart, basically, though the biggest contributor was the speculator bubble finally bursting. See, somehow, everyone had managed to ignore one simple logical flaw. Old comic books became valuable collector's items because there weren't a lot of them left, because no one had ever thought they'd be valuable collector's items. But since these new books were being bought and sold with that in mind, there were tons of them out there, so they weren't going to go up in value anytime soon. Oh, and since the publishers had turned their universes into pandering Dark Age messes chasing sales trends to create collectibles, you wound up with not only a surplus of comics, but a surplus of bad comics nobody was eager to revisit. The bottom fell out of the market, sales plummeted, stores closed, and many, many people lost their jobs. It was really more of a slow-motion train wreck than an immediate thing, but some like to tag 1996 as the year of the Great Comics Crash because of the mega-disaster that was Marvel Comics filing for bankruptcy. Oh, and the guys at Image? Well, for all their good intentions, as businessmen, they were pretty good cartoonists. Egos, work ethics, schedules clashed almost immediately, very few of them could actually write all that well on their own, and while the company never fully fell apart, the dream of a sustainable, independent full challenger to Marvel and DC was never fully realized either, especially since one of the team's star players, Todd McFarlane, turned out to be more interested in becoming a merchandising mogul than in making comics. In the wake of all of this, the comics industry got much, much smaller, even as the popular culture presence of its properties got much, much greater, and the ripple effects of the disastrous 90s continue to be felt well into the 21st century. In fact, one of the most infamous dust-ups from that era is back in the news this year, and I'll try to explain what it was next week. I'm Bob, and that was 90s Month.